No one expected anything of him. No, he wasn't touted as the next heavyweight champ of the world. He broke through, true Cinderella story.
Jimmy Braddock was a major, major star, a hope, a star in the sky, a star in the headlines for the Depression era. The Depression starved, literally, fan, identified with him. He had been on welfare. He had made something of himself, come off welfare, and was a champion.
He stood up to everyone. He lost one fight on a cut. And then when he was given the opportunity, even though he was on the downslide and past any peak he could have achieved as a fighter had he been handled properly, he still had enough in him to win the big fights.
And this was why people identified with him. In a sense, he wasn't a breed apart the way that many heavyweight champions are, almost freaks of nature. Braddock was a very ordinary guy. He was the kind of guy people could relate to. He was a man off the streets. He was a man like them. He was a man who fought the Depression. He was a man who sort of climbed up by his own bootstraps. And therefore, the fight encapsulated everything that he was, and he went out a champion.
Jimmy Braddock was the essence of the true-blooded American who had a lot of courage, who fought obstacles. Sometimes he lost, but sometimes he won, but he never gave up.
The Cinderella Man, James J. Braddock.
During the 20s and 30s, three of the most popular sports in America were baseball, horse racing, and boxing. Millions of people listened to boxing on the radio every day. During the Depression, Americans needed heroes, and they found them in their World Series winners, champion racehorses, and boxing champions.
Braddock stepped back out of the way. Braddock's boxing skill carried him clear of that right hand.
Jimmy went in like a fighting tiger, showing all of that Irish courage that he had.
The winner and new heavyweight champion!
For as long as the history of boxing will be told, one man will be recognized as the Cinderella Man. James J. Braddock was considered a routine challenger for the then heavyweight champion Max Beyer. But in one of the greatest upsets of all time, Braddock proved what hard work, a stubborn nature, and a little luck of the Irish can achieve.
Braddock was a likable fellow, and he was an everyman. His story was something that appealed to people, and for that reason, he was really very popular.
James Braddock was born in the once notorious Hell's Kitchen district of New York City on June the 7th, 1905. He grew up in an era of Irish-American boxing champions, so his boyhood heroes were boxers. Braddock was still a young child when the family moved across the river from New York City to New Jersey. He fought professionally for the first time when he was only 20 in a four-round no-decision bout against Al Settle in West Hoboken, New Jersey.
Jim Braddock made his name for himself as a pretty good power-punching middleweight in the New Jersey amateur Golden Gloves back in 1924, 25, 26.
In 1926, Jim Braddock went unbeaten in the small halls of New Jersey and New York City and began to make a name for himself.
One of the things that really distinguished him at that time is even as a middleweight, 162, 163 pounds, he was fighting heavyweights. And in fact, he won the Golden Glove Championship in New Jersey both in 1925 and 1926 at heavyweight, even though he only weighed 160, 162 pounds.
Almost from the beginning, Braddock was handled by one-time door-to-door salesman Joe Gould. Braddock and the surprisingly savvy 5'2" Gould would share a partnership that would last the boxer's entire career.
it was like a marriage at first sight. They hit it off well. Joe Gould, little guy, 5'2", and there's Jimmy Bragg, 6'2", but lean at the time. And he took him under his wing, and they became close. And it was a meeting that was profitable down the road for both of them, for monies and his relationship between two people.
Joel Gould was an interesting character. One of the things that really distinguished him from the run-of-the-mill fight manager was his loyalty. He and Braddock immediately developed an amazing friendship that lasted through the course of both their lives. Joe Gould was absolutely devoted to Jim Braddock and would haunt the offices of Madison Square Garden and any other promoter, touting Jim Braddock as the next coming champion. Even though Jim had only a few fights under his belt, Gould was absolutely out there speaking to anyone and everyone he could about him and just simply singing his praises to everyone.
By 1928, Jim Braddock firmly established himself as a world title contender.
He's only 24 years old. He's been in the ring 3 years, and in that short time, he's come up very, very fast. He's had 46 fights, he's lost only two, and he's won more than half his fights by clean knockout.
Within 3 years, he established himself as a top-rated contender with victories over Jimmy Slattery and Tuffy Griffiths, which put him in line for a shot against Tommy Loughran, great light heavyweight champion.
Tommy Loughran was known as one of the supreme ring artists of his generation. Jim knew he would be a difficult opponent. He would have to fight, not box him.
The Tommy Loughran fight is the fight that really defines Jimmy Braddock early on. Jimmy Braddock's a tall guy, a big puncher with his right hand, and he's looking to knock everybody out. And he's had a lot of success so far. But now he gets in a ring with Tommy Loughran. Tommy Loughran was considered by many people to be perhaps the greatest light heavyweight who ever lived.
There was a guy from Philadelphia, Tommy Loughran, going against New Jersey, Jimmy Braddock. Half of New Jersey was at ringside yelling for Braddock to bring the title home for them. Tommy Loughran, he had such a superior jab, his left jab. And once he zeroed in on your head, he very rarely missed. No matter where you moved, his left jab was in your face. He bloodied up Braddock's face pretty bad. Though Braddock went forward throughout the entire fight, never gave up an inch, just kept moving forward, trying for the knockout. And after 8 rounds, when Braddock's face was a bloody mess, Joe Gould, his manager, asked him in the corner, "Stop some of those lefts, Jim." And his remark was, "I'm stopping every one of them, not going by me."
At the end of those 15 rounds in Yankee Stadium, Jim Braddock didn't quite have what it took to become the victor. Loughran was awarded the decision.
Well, here's the decision. Tommy Loughran gets the unanimous decision and retires as undefeated light heavyweight champion.
In the dressing room after the Loughran fight, Tommy pointed to his left shoulder, which was completely bruised. And he said to the reporters, "You see this bruise here? That's from Braddock's left hand. He only threw it a few times during the fight. But if that kid ever learns how to jab, he's going to be champion."
After that fight, it takes a lot of heart out of you when you're a pro for 3 years, have a good record, and you get your shot and you lose it.
Here's a guy, a young fighter, had fought for the light heavyweight championship of the world, and then slowly, for no real good reason, starts to lose a bout, break a hand, lose another bout, win a bout, break a hand again, break a collarbone. Things didn't seem to be going right for him.
His hand badly broken from his last fight, Jim visited a doctor who told him that the hand would have to be rebroken before he could set it. Jim couldn't afford the cost of properly breaking his hand, so he broke it on purpose in his next fight and then went back to his doctor to have it set.
Physical limitations placed on him by these injuries, the types of fights he